Greetings, and welcome to my helpful tips about Victorian. If you just started this game, or if you're about to start this game, and you're looking for some helpful pointers, then you have come to the right place. To be honest, this guide turned out to be longer than expected. I wanted to just give you some short tips, and, well, I kinda just went on. And I will just put some timestamps in the description and some links I collected. Yeah, that's it. Enjoy the video. Alright, so let's have a look at the inventory first. And this is basically it, what you get from Victorian about your character development. There are no class selections and there are no talent trees. So it's quite simplistic and not overwhelming, but I find it to still not be shallow. So you have a lot of ways to tweak your character up to your playstyle how you like it, but you don't have to care about too much complicated systems. So, well, that's that. You have your health, you have your armor. Armor is the only defensive stat in this game. So it also determines if you get hit at all and how much damage you take. It is the same for the monsters, so armor penetration is quite important. And then you just have your weapon damage, critical hit chance and critical hit damage. In Victorian you also get magic, and the spells you get are called demon powers. There are a lot of different ones. There's damage, utility, buffing, debuffing and even healing. And you need a resource called Overdrive to be able to use them. This is somewhat your mana in this game, and the way you acquire Overdrive is mostly influenced by your outfit. So the outfit in a way determines which playstyle you have and which class you are. And the Destiny cards just provide you with statistical benefits. They are somewhat the Destiny cards, the closest thing Victorian gives you, which you are used with talent points in other games. After the short tutorial mission, you can select your outfit. And in the tutorial mission itself, you are stuck with the Hunter's outfit, but you can just pick another one after that. The selection might vary, which depending on the DLCs you have installed, and you can acquire every outfit throughout the game. So you can switch up your playstyle while you're playing, but of course you're stuck in the early stages with whatever outfit you pick now. Yeah, basically the Hunter's outfit is the more damage you take, the more overdrive you gain. You gain overdrive with normal attacks, but yeah, the outfit tweaks that and gives you additional boni or something. So if you take damage with the Hunter's outfit, you get more overdrive you can use. The Cavalier's outfit or the Wanderer's outfit for my DLCs, this is just a different skin of the same outfit. Your normal attacks don't generate overdrive anymore, but you get a steady flow of overdrive. So in a way you don't get a burst of overdrive, but you have a steady flow of income. With the Vigilante's outfit you get a bonus to your critical hit chance of 10%, but you don't generate overdrive with normal attacks anymore. So you only get overdrive with critical strikes, but you get a lot more than you would get with a normal attack. Okay, so that's that. I personally prefer the Vigilantes. After selecting your outfit, you can choose your difficulty. It pretty much is what it reads in the description, but I would need to tell you a bit about hexes. A hex is a feature in this game which lets you put a buff on the monsters or a debuff on yourself, and the more hexes you have active, the more experience points you gain and the more items you find. So in general you want to have as much hexes enabled as you can handle. Also in hard mode, the monsters are a bit stronger, and the hexes are enabled by default and you can't turn them off. So yeah, this is the difference here. After that you can decide whether to be a hardcore character or a normal character. With a hardcore character in this game, if you die, your character is not gone, it just becomes a normal character. And the only real distinction is that normal characters share your stash. So you could transfer an item from one character to another. You can't do that with hardcore characters, they are somewhat self-found. Apart from that, a hardcore character, it's just about the satisfaction and achievement to get a hardcore character through the game. So you know you have done it without dying. And that's basically it. So this is your base of operations, which you enter after your tutorial mission. This is the crafting area, this is a merchant. Then in this area back there, there will be your stash. And the vendor on this end, there you can buy destiny cards. And this is just a map where you select your mission. Up the stairs, you find your training dummies. And that's basically it, there's a sub base. I switched to the character of my first playthrough, and now I can show you some more things. The hexes I talked about, you can find them in this tab of an inventory. They pretty much just do what they read. In general, monsters hit harder, they're tougher, they're faster, they have a chance to become elites, and you take damage over time in a mission. About the Hex of Tenacity. Every champion and boss monster gets additional armor anyways, and with this hex you also give them 120 armor more. Every monster gets it, the normal ones, the champions and the bosses. But still, I found to be quite okay with about 150 armor penetration. And the demon powers ignore armor, so even if you have less than required armor penetration, your demon powers give you a way to work around that. But yeah, basically I played on normal mode and I was fine with about 150, and everything above is quite okay, but I wouldn't go out of my way to get more than 150 on normal mode. I will briefly show you which outfits you can get in this game. I won't explain them all too much because they pretty much just do as they read in the description. You notice the green number in the description. Green numbers in the descriptions are usually the ones you can upgrade with crafting in this game. So, the Vigilante's outfit, you only get overdrive with critical hits, but you gain a lot more. So, you are able to snowball pretty hard. So this is a reason why I really prefer this outfit. It just is the most powerful one, in my opinion. But, well, it's up to your playstyle, this is just my personal opinion. I didn't upgrade the outfits, some I did partially, so you can't compare the numbers directly, but you get an idea what they do. So the Vanguard's outfit is a bit more of a tankery approach, like a battery. With the overdrive, and you gain a lot of armor and armor penetration, but your overdrive gain is a bit diminished. The Adventurer's outfit enables you for more build diversity because you get one more destiny card slot and increases your overdrive. The Hunter outfit is, well, get damage, get more overdrive, and yeah, punch back harder. The Wanderer's outfit, the same as the Cavalier's outfit, just a different skin. You don't gain overdrive in other ways, you just get it on a per second basis. So a steady flow, but you can't get a burst. The Highlander's outfit focuses on you using your weapons and the special attacks, and this is the only way to gain overdrive with special attacks, so that's that. The Zealot's outfit, it's just a tanking outfit in my opinion. I don't see a reason to use it over the Vanguards, but yeah, it's up to you. I'm not sure. I think the Vanguards might be an DLC outfit, I think. Maybe that's the reason the Zealots is in there. But yeah, that's that. As you level up in Victorian, you gain additional loot as a bonus. Up to the maximum level, you get a selection between different things you can choose. And it doesn't stop at maximum level. After that, you gain renown levels. So even after you hit maximum level, you still benefit from more experience gain. As you don't get an item with a huge immediate upgrade, and if you are able to choose a gift box, go for the gift box, as long as you don't get a really huge immediate upgrade. The gift boxes can be combined, three white ones create a green one, three green ones create a yellow one, and three yellow ones create a purple one, an epic one, and if you open this one, you get an epic item, like an epic weapon. So they are really desirable, because epic stuff is of course the rarest in the game. So yeah, whenever you can, and you don't get an immediate huge upgrade while you're leveling up, pick the gift box. To be honest, I don't remember if you can select power stones as loot bonus while leveling up as well. Basically, they're just an ability for you to cut corners in crafting. You normally need to use a lot of different materials to apply an effect to your destiny card or your weapon, and a power stone lets you just do it with the power stone itself. If you have the option to select a power stone or acquire one, I think the only real ones worth aiming for are the ones that apply a divine or a wicked effect to your destiny cards. It's just an additional bonus you can apply it to your destiny cards. There are different divine effects and different wicked effects, but doing it without the power stone is a bit tedious in my opinion. Everything else you can do with the crafting is easily accessible enough in my opinion. Okay, so a big part of this game is the crafting. I will come to that in a bit. And the destiny cards I also need to explain. While I was playing this game at the start, I was wondering which stuff I could really sell. In general, sell all the green weapons and the white weapons. The yellow ones you should keep because you need them for crafting and upgrading. And apart from that, you should keep everything else. Every destiny card, every demon power, keep it because you really need it for crafting. And well, the green weapons and the white weapons you gain, if you sell them, they provide pretty much enough cash for you to buy every stuff.
Let's have a look at the crafting or transportation next.
In general, it says, or the explanation is on the left side, it's some kind of pyramid system. Mostly it's combine three lesser items and gain a better one. For example, with the destiny cards, you can combine three of that type, and you will get the green version. I combine three white ones and gain the green one, and I can combine three of them to gain the epic version. And so on. So it's just a pyramid system. With weapons, it's a bit different. I can put in three yellow ones, but I don't automatically get a legendary weapon out of that. There's a small chance and it happens, but it's very rare. So in general, if I do that, I will just get a random yellow weapon with a slight chance to get a legendary weapon. But with Destiny cards, it always, if there is a higher tier, you will get it. It's important to note that for the Destiny cards, not every Destiny card type has an epic version. Some stop even at the green stage, and some only have yellow, and there's even one that is only white, the Fool. Yeah. So that's important to know, because you can buy the Destiny cards quite regularly. They're quite cheap, and with just selling green weapons, you will have enough money to just buy them. But just don't buy out the whole shop. You should focus on the ones that have epic versions. And I think I will just put a link to the wiki, where you can check if your Destiny card type has an legendary version. Okay, apart from that, you can upgrade statistics. Let's just smack it in. It always shows you what item you would need in order to get an upgrade. In this, any legendary demon power. So I could just smack in a legendary demon power, and I get a preview of what statistical gain I would get. Alright, so the weapon crafting is a bit more complicated, as you can see. And by crafting I really mean upgrading, because there's no way to get a specific type of weapon crafted. You can combine three weapons and get a random new one, but that's it. You can't go directly for the weapon you want to have. And therefore you're stuck with upgrading weapons you found. Alright, so each weapon can have a prefix and an affix, and it just shows in that order. You always get the weapon damage on top. You can upgrade that with three weapons of the same tier, rarity. Then you get the critical hit chance. You can upgrade that with three rare Destiny cards, or epic ones in, for epic weapons, or legendary weapons. And then the next statistic is your prefix, Wishes, which increases your critical hit damage, and the affix of the Assassin, which increases your critical hit chance. Apart from which statistics the weapon got from the prefix and the affix, you can apply a third one. And this is a bit more complicated. Oh well, not really complicated, but in this case the game doesn't really tell you how to do it. If you want to apply a third statistic or effect, you need three epic demon powers. So, for example, on this weapon, the Vicious effect I already got, of the Assassin effect, and I added the Cursed effect. So more damage, but less gold drops. And in order to apply that, I used one epic or legendary Berserk Aura and two legendary Dark Mist Auras, and I just put them in, transmuted, and the effect is applied. And to upgrade it further, you need the same demon powers. For the upgrading, it doesn't matter which quality they have, and this is also the reason why you want to keep your low level demon powers as well and don't sell them, because you need a lot of them later on when you want to upgrade your weapons to maximum level and efficiency and effect. And yeah, but yeah, to apply an effect, you would need to know which demon powers combine this effect. For example, the Vicious effect is three times Purging Flame. So if I have a weapon that doesn't have the Vicious prefix and I want to apply that, I would need to put in three legendary Purging Flame demon powers here.
Okay, so now you know how to apply an effect on your weapon. Now is the question which ones you want to have on your weapon. And this is open to opinion, of course, and everyone has a different play style. I think when it comes to just get a high damaging weapon, you should have the three effects: critical hit damage, critical hit chance, and a flat damage increase. There are two effects that increase the weapon damage. The one gives you a debuff in gold, but gives you a higher increase in damage. And that's the cursed one, like you can read here, cursed. And I will always prefer that over the effect that flat gives you damage without the gold debuff. It's called devastating. But you make so much gold by selling green weapons, you don't need the extra gold. So you can just live very well with decreased gold drops. That's no problem at all. So, if you want to have a high damaging weapon, the prefix needs to be either vicious or cursed, like this one, and the affix needs to be of the assassin. And then you will just apply the third effect according to whichever prefix you have. If you already have vicious, you apply the cursed effect. If you have the cursed effect, you would apply the vicious effect with three legendary purging flames. Critical damage, this is a vicious effect, and to apply the effect, you need the legendary kind of whatever it's showing you for upgrading. Okay, so apart from applying effects to your weapon, you also want to have a look for the higher base damage or the highest base damage you can get to just get the best end result. As a general idea, the more elaborate the weapon icon looks, the higher the base damage is. I don't know the highest icon for every weapon type because I didn't have the patience to wait for the best drops with the set of prefix and affix. But yeah, I will tell you at least the best or second best icons so you can just have a look out for. So this is the best for the hammers. I think this is the best for the mortars, and this is the best for the lightning guns. For the rapiers, I think the one with the skull is the best. As you can see, this is the same item. It's just by a very small margin, but well, anyways. I think this is the best for the scythes. And this, I'm pretty sure that's only the second best for the shotguns, but anyways, the difference isn't too big. And I'm very sure this is the best icon with the highest base damage for the swords. And this should be the best for the tomes. I'm not too sure about the tomes, but at least, if not, it's the second best. Alright, so this only leaves the farming setup to be explained. You're pretty stuck in this regard because you want to have the Elder effect for more XP. You want to have the extraordinary luck effect for finding better items. Just a higher tier, so if a green weapon drops for you, it has a chance to become a yellow one, for example. And you want to find more items, so just more item drop. And the problem is, with extraordinary luck, you can't upgrade that. So you don't know which demon power combination applies that. At least I didn't find it out. If you find it on the internet, good for you. I didn't. So I was stuck with getting a weapon with the Elder prefix and the affix extraordinary luck, and then I just applied the luck effect with legendary demon powers. So you can just see what you need for the luck effect. You need blink, diamond, and time bubble in legendary, and for the Elder, you would need Boomerang, Dark Mist, and Diamond.
in Legendary that is. But yeah, Elder you would need to have anyways, because you need extraordinary luck on it already. You want to apply luck, so Elder has to be there as well already. Alright, so now there are destiny cards left to be explained. You need a lot of legendary destiny cards for crafting, so the one point would be to get as much legendary destiny cards as possible, and therefore you need to know that not every destiny card has a legendary version. I will just put a link in the description so you can know which destiny card has a legendary version. There are a lot of ones, and I won't go over every single one of them. And the description just says what it does, and in this game the description is pretty precise. The inventory changes every now and then, so just go back every mission and have a look. Alright, so apart from just getting legendary destiny cards for your crafting, of course you want to have some for your build. And as very specific thing you want to aim for is to apply an effect to your destiny card. There are wicked effects, like on my vampire card, or divine effects. There are different divine effects and different wicked effects. The problem is that you can't really target to get a specific effect. So you have the option to apply either a wicked or divine effect, but you can't specifically target one, so you are a bit just up to RNGesus. And there are different ways to go about. You either just hope for your divine or wicked effect to appear on the inventory of the vendor and just buy it out. You can use power stones to apply a divine or wicked effect to your destiny card that you like, or you can craft it. In my opinion, the crafting is extremely tedious. Depending on your build, you want to have the divine or wicked effect on a specific tier of your card. May it be green, yellow, or legendary, or even white. The point is that if you have a divine or wicked effect on a card you really like, and you can't just upgrade that card to a higher tier and keep the wicked or divine effect, because in order to do so, to get a higher tier, you need to use the card itself, and the outcome is random. So in order to get a divine or wicked effect on a card, a random one, you need to combine three ones that already have a divine or wicked effect. So let's say you want to have a vampire card with a wicked effect. You need to combine three vampire cards with a wicked effect already on it, and after that you get a higher tier with a random wicked effect. This is so tedious and up to RNGesus. In my opinion, it's not worth to go on the normal way. I personally just stuck with the cards I had in my build, and I just applied power stones for either wicked or divine as I got them, and just hope for the best. And I just stuck with it. Just wait for getting power stones as a random drop, and just apply them to your destiny cards to your liking and hope for the best. This is at least my advice, even though it might take a while to get what you want, but the other way is just too tedious. Okay, so as the last step, I want to explain my build. As I said, this won't be a comprehensive guide, so I won't go over every build there is. I will just explain my build and why it worked and why I liked it. Normally, in every role-playing game or RPG, I'd first go and try for the normal damage build and crowd control build. And in this game, it worked so well, I just stuck with it right away. So the Vigilante outfit, it gives you a bonus to critical hit chance. You generate overdrive for your demon powers only with critical hits, but with each critical hit you get so much overdrive, it's really worth it. And especially because the swords give you a guaranteed critical hit every now and then in the combo, it works very well even from the start. So yeah, that's that. On another hand, the lightning gun is extremely versatile, and it has so much chance to get your critical hits. It works extremely well with this build. So it's more crowd control, critical hit based build with the Vigilante's outfit. And if you can have it, get the Lucky Rabbit's Foot. It ensures you critical hit chance for 100%. So you really get critical hits if you are unlucky or if you really need critical hits in a way. Swords just guarantee critical hits in the combo. And then you have a very... It's just, in my opinion, the lightning gun is the best overall weapon because it provides crowd control, damage, and a good area of effect. And you're bound to get critical hits anyways. So yeah, that's just the thing. And for the demon powers, I like to have one defensive and one offensive. And in my opinion, the best defensive demon power is a time bubble. And there are some demon powers that are a bit more potent in your defensive regard, but time bubble also lets you gain overdrive while it's active. So that is a thing to consider, in my opinion. The Chalkwave legendary is, in my opinion, the best offensive demon power because it has a nice area of effect. It applies a crowd control, it is good damage, and you can target it. For example, other demon powers have some kind of random area of effect. For example, the meteor, you can't specifically determine where the meteors land, so there's a bit of RNGs involved. But with the shockwave, it's always going outwards from you in a radius that is determined, and that is quite decent, and it applies a crowd control, the crippling. So yeah, in my opinion, this is the best setup. You have the ability to slow stuff around you, you have the ability to crowd control, damage, push, knockback in a targeted area that you know where it's landing. So yeah, that's the setup I like. Okay, so let's explain my Destiny card setup. And you're bound to a certain amount. I have only 20 points to my disposal. If you are going for all hexes, especially with the Hex of Tenacity, I think you need to have the beast in your build to just get this 90 armor penetration. Apart from that, I found Vampire for Lifesteal to be extremely handy. You have the option to get healing potions, and that's a rather short cooldown, or you have Vampire Blood for Lifesteal potions.
which is potent as well. I personally found to be extremely comfortable with having Vampire in my setup. So I think the Beast on Legendary version, if you go for Hex of Tenacity, is a must. Apart from that, because I like to go with critical hit chance and critical hit damage build, I think the legendary version of Drogue for 150% critical damage is, in my opinion, a must. Then just increase your critical hit chance with strength. If I could, I would have gone with a higher tier, like yellow or even legendary, but I just don't have the points, and I'd rather go for Divine Rogue with a higher critical hit damage, because swords and the Lucky Rabbit's Foot can ensure critical damage. So yeah, I just rather have higher critical damage than having a higher critical chance. The legendary version is 12%, so I'm not missing out on that much. But yeah, I think armor penetration on legendary and critical hit damage on legendary is the most benefit for my build, so I just went with it. And I just used the last slot for my preferred weapon type. It's the lightning gun, so I just went with Divine Lightning with Rogue and Beast on legendary. This is, in my opinion, mandatory. Then I just went with the highest Vampire and Strength version I could get, and in this case it's green because I'm limited to 20 points. And that's basically it. It's, as you can see, it has a bit of healing with Vampire, and apart from that it's basically just damage. It's armor penetration, it's critical hit damage, it's critical chance, and a bonus and benefit for your primary weapon. And it worked extremely well for me in normal weapon, a normal difficulty, and I'm pretty sure it would work quite fine as well on hard mode. Okay, so I will just show you on the map the best farming location, in my opinion. That's the Collector's Residence. It's a very short mission, and you have the complete loot table at your disposal. So the Collector's Residence is a very short mission or instance. I will just show you my route. Basically, get up here, get the regeneration fountain and the damage buff. Make sure you pick up this champion pack. Get the Collector himself and just run to the end. If you do it properly, all the champion packs follow you to the end, and you can just pop your cooldowns and kill them all. The good thing is that every champion pack here has a random loot table for the demon powers. So as long as you're not targeting anything specific, this is your best farming spot overall, because you can get everything the game has to offer potentially here. Every legendary weapon, demon power or destiny card. I would recommend to backtrack for the chest in the collector's room, but apart from that, I wouldn't recommend to completely backtrack to the very first mobs. They won't follow you to the end, but they usually they're just normal mobs, and they don't drop a demon power or anything specific. Alright, so I hope you enjoyed the video and got some helpful tips out of it, and see you in the next video.